John Brady to Dermot McCabe, Dermot McCabe to Ronan Carlin, he's in, the keeper's beaten, and the post stoppage. Oh, a nice piece of play by Mickey Boyle, getting away for Finbar Riley, getting away as well from the left half back, and he's in, and across comes Damien O'Reilly. He's got the signal from referee Curran, here's the chance, and a terrific save by John O'Connor.
The width of a post, a bounce of a ball, a bad miss. Factors that will decide who will win the race to the Ulster title. Well, today, Monaghan entered that race against hot favourites, Donegal. At Ballybofey, either Donegal or Monaghan will be pipped at the post for a semi-final spot in the Ulster Championship.
Can he find a way through? Looking for Paddy Hegarty!
In Leinster, Dublin step out in defence of their title against a Louth team confident of causing an upset.
Free kick, taking it quickly himself. Oh, it's a goal!
In hurling, Derry and Down cross swords in the semi-final of the Ulster Minor Hurling Championship.
This is Danny McGrellis now. There's a chance of a goal for Derry. What a score!
And after the grueling demands of the championship, what better than a restful break in Portugal? Programme with some marvellous action ahead of us. Here in the studio we have our resident expert Brian McAniff, and alongside him this week's guest, Cabin Boss Martin McHugh. Well, we'll hear from them later, but let's get on with today's action and move straight to Ballybofey and join our commentary team of Down Boss Peter McGrath, but picking it up first, as ever, Jimmy McGee.
Ballybofey is packed, both town and ground, for this all-ticket game. 4 weeks ago, Donegal dethroned the All-Ireland champions Down, but today they show one change from that match. John Duffy, who's trained very little since then, is out, and in comes 1992 All-Ireland star Declan Bonner. 11 members of this team were on the team that won the Sam Maguire Cup in 1992, among them fullback Matt Gallagher, who 10 years earlier in 1982 was on the first ever Donegal team to win an All-Ireland, the under-21s. Now 32 years old, Matt is from the Naive Breed Ballantrae Club. He's a publican. He has 3 Ulster Championship medals, 1 All-Ireland, 1 under-21, and of course is an All-Star as well. Made his debut against Leash back in 1981, and in all, he's made 126 appearances for Donegal. So how will he feel about putting on, as he has done, this jersey for the 127th time?
Oh yeah, that's probably the biggest buzz of the whole lot. When you get the jersey and... You run out onto the pitch and you hear the roar for the first time in the championship, like, that really makes you feel good. And you always say, well, maybe this year we'll get another run at it, you know, so.
Monaghan, after a good league campaign, have hope and confidence in equal amounts. In the past, 2 championships that has taken the eventual All-Ireland champions to put them out. Injured Jerry McGurk will be a considerable loss. His place at centre-half back goes to championship debutant 20-year-old Joe Coyle. In fact, the entire half-back line is new to championship football, and between them, their ages are 22 years younger than the half-forward line they will oppose. Number 13 for Monaghan is Stephen McGinnity. He has scored in 3 of his last 4 championship games. He's 24 years old. His occupation, he's an office manager from Monaghan Mushrooms. Made his debut 5 years ago in the National League against Mayo and is regarded as one of the most lethal finishers in the modern game. But why is Gaelic football his number one love?
Well, I suppose I've been playing it since I was probably 7 years of age, you know. And like, I think, like, of all the things that I really do, it's one thing that I'd really like to be very successful in, like, in relation to anything else at all.
The referee for the big game is Jimmy Curran from the Ard Boat Club in County Tyrone. He's been refereeing, Jimmy has, for 20 years. And in those 2 decades, many make honours, including the 1992 Ulster final, won then, of course, by Donegal. Bit of a wind here, but the big onus today for me, Peter McGrath, is the Monaghan half-forward line. They must work.
There's no doubt about that. They must defend, because the Donegal half-back line, as we all know, is very attack-minded. So Monaghan half-forward line must defend as well as attack here today.
James McHugh. getting away from Joe Coyle. Now, who's first to respond here? Why, it's McHugh again. And what a start for Donegal. James McHugh. How quick he was to respond when the ball came off the upright. That's the key to the old thing called experience, Peter.
Yes, he actually took the shot himself. And the Monaghan defence seemed to stand still. McHugh came back in again and was then taken down inside the small square.
Lovely run by McHugh, really incisive. And David King brought him down as he bore down a goal for the second time. Penalty for Donegal. The offence happened within the first half minute of the game. Declan Bonner, now 30 years old from Narossa. He's got the signal from referee Curran. Here's the chance. And a terrific save by John O'Connor. What a morale booster that is to himself and his Monaghan colleagues.
Yes, it wasn't particularly well struck. Declan Bonner obviously went for power rather than precision. And John O'Connor, who's a big goalkeeper, had no bother parrying the ball out for a 45.
Nonetheless, super boost for Monaghan. Now it's Manus Boyle. Quite a considerable wind blowing here. Can Manus use it? Here's the answer. No, he cannot. Distance, no problem. Accuracy, yes. John O'Connor, whose great-grandfather played in the first ever All-Ireland football final, I believe. Mark Crossan, Brian Murray for Donegal. Look at the space James McHugh has. Duffy, the centre-back, was sucked into midfield. Here's McHugh, scooting through again. Uses Manus Boyle. Chance of a score. This time it's over the bar. And early indications that McHugh could be troublesome.
Almost certainly Joe Coyle making his championship debut will have to be an awful lot tighter in his marking of James McHugh. He got an awful lot of space here, and with a beautiful fisted pass found Manus Boyle, who had no problem pointing.
Martin Slowey from Monaghan looks inside for Declan Smith. Good piece of fielding by Smith against Barry McGowan. McGowan had an excellent game against Mickey Linden in the first round, the preliminary round of this championship. Faced today by Declan Smith. Smith himself, he was in bed with flu earlier this week, didn't train on Friday, but here he is, ready to make his presence felt. And he does. It's Monaghan's first score, and the scores are level in Ballybofey. Gary Walsh here playing his 120th game for Donegal today. Big fielding by Mark McShane. Martin Gavigan accepts the short pass. Now, Gavigan has to go it alone. Ah, it's a simple point. Terrific point by Gavigan. All the forwards pulled out to leave him the room. Good play off the ball by Donegal, Peter.
Yes, it was an excellent piece of fielding by Mark McShane, who found Martin Gavigan, and who uncharacteristically with his left foot scores a very fine point indeed.
Murphy to Martin Slowey. Slowey to Joe Coyle. Look at the pace of the centre back. He to John Connor. Coyle's gone away and left two, one, two, three Donegal people on mark. Now somebody wisely has told him to come back. Here's Stephen McGinnity. Martin shoving on him, no foul. Now breaks to Gregory Flanagan. Flanagan faced by John Joe Doherty, knocks it back to Declan Lockman. And Gary Walsh went for it, but it came off the angle. It's in the net. And Declan Lockman, not a renowned striker, it's got to be said. But what a goal and what a boost, Peter.
Yes, rather like the goal which Fermanagh got a fortnight ago against Tyrone. A speculative shot in. But John Duffy here does great work. Takes on Matt Gallagher, can't find a way through. Feeds the ball back to Lockman. Now you think Gary Walsh has the ball under control, but it comes off the underside of the crossbar and into the net.
Monaghan, true to their reputation. Brian Murray and Stephen McGinnity in a little altercation. McGinnity is the one who's down. Next time you go off. That's pretty clear. But it takes two to tango, Peter.
Well, it certainly does. and there was a clear case of retaliation by Brian Murray. The referee took a very lenient view. Sometimes a lack of consistency in this respect.
Declan Smith has sufficiently settled down to face up to this free kick. 35 metres out, he hits it well. Has he got the direction? He has. That's another very good point by Declan Smith. Ness Lachman, the goal scorer, looking for it through. And it gets through to Smith again. What an assured young man he is. What an assured footballer. Declan Smith, over the bar. He might have been in bed with flu on Friday night, but whatever cure he took, it worked.
Yes, Declan Lachman's actually playing in the half-forward line, leaving Smith up front, and he took that with the outside of his left foot. A beautiful score.
Stephen McGinnity down injured. There's a charged atmosphere here today. Here's Paddy Haggerty. Looks up at target, feels it might be too far. Now it's Brian Murray. Brian Murray going right through the heart of the defence. And Murray taking his point as Monaghan players lined up to make contact. Good point, though. Michael Slowey. Slowey looking for Peter Duffy, who's running very well. Coming diagonally across the line of attack. Goes for a narrow angle. What a point! What a magnificent point by Peter Duffy, whose feature of this game so far has been his diagonal runs from right out forward, right across the park. Good score.
Yes, he's finding a lot of space, and for a young man making his championship debut, he hit that with great confidence. Tremendous point.
Descent shown by Mark Crossan. Now it's John Connell, the left half back. And Monaghan are playing with a flow and a panache that really does the backroom team proud. And this young team, here's Joe Coyle. Turnover by Mark, by James McHugh. Mark Crossan now. Crossan to Martin Gaffey. Look at the strength. His would-be marker bounced off him. James McHugh. Manus Boyle. Good fetch by Manus. PJ McGowan off the bench early. And right around the other side of the field, doing a lap that at the moment isn't getting anything out of his team, but this time it's Manus Boyle with his second point and Donegal's fourth. One of the things that Peter McGrath and I talked about before the game was the ability or otherwise of the Monaghan half forward line to do some work. Well, the answer to that is that not once today have we seen Shovlin or Noel Haggerty attacking as they usually do for Donegal.
Yes, another very, very accurate through ball played there. And Donegal at this stage is the team under pressure. Monaghan have come like a breath of fresh air into this game and have taken the game right to their more illustrious opponents.
The young man with the ball is Declan Smith. He feels he can't miss today. And he's right, you know. That's outside the 45-metre line. And he has now scored 4 points in this game. Broken down there by Frank McEnany. Haggerty to Murray. Mark McShane looking for Tony Boyle. And how about that for a piece of clean fielding by David King. Magnificent catch. PJ McGowan has done his lap of the field. He's checked all the players and everything. Tony Boyle trying to get away from David King. King stays goal side of him. Declan Bonner blocked down by Gregory Flanagan. Great work by Flanagan. Michael Slowey. The Monaghan fans in the crowd, 4,000 of them from Monaghan here today. Slowey drops it a bit short to Gary Walsh. Martin Gavigan. Being attended to here. And if he should have to go, what a huge, huge loss he would be to Donegal.
No doubt about that. Donegal are struggling all over the field. Monaghan players are winning possession in situations where really they shouldn't win it.
Well, it looked as though it was Joe Coyle coming in here on him. Joe Coyle in possession. That's where the elbow came back, but you've got to say in Coyle's favour, he certainly didn't mean that.
Definitely not. No, it was purely elbow movement as he was running away from Martin Galvigan. Martin was unlucky enough just to get the point of his elbow just on his eyebrow.
Well, they call him Rambo. I suppose it's right in character, the headdress now.
So playing the pass for another great point. And certainly at this stage you'd have to say that Monaghan are fully deserving of their lead. Playing great football.
And they started off again with Michael Slowey inside looking for Declan Smith. Barry McGowan gets fingertips to it. Stephen McGinnity picked off the ground. And the free kick to Donegal. John Joe Doherty. Mark McGinnity. John Conlon hanging out of him. Take it easy, really, is the word from the referee, Jimmy Curran. David King gets a tear. Joe Coyle. Tony Boyle. There are those who think Donegal would be better served with Boyle as a half forward. Well, he's got to come deep to look for action now. This is just inside the 45 metre line. And they really need a score, the Donegal. Just 4 points on the board after 28 minutes. Declan Bonner. Looks nice. Yes, it is. Number 19 is John Duffy from Eirua. One of the deadliest forwards in the country over the last couple of years. But then hasn't really trained since the demise of Don 4 weeks ago. But now he's ready to come in. It's Manus Boyle. Manus Boyle and all Haggerty. And a terrific finish by Haggerty. Just a glimpse, just a warning of the power of Haggerty breaking from the back. This young man gaining in stature as the game goes on, Joe Coyle. It's down to Tony Boyle. Tony Boyle outfields King this time. That's a free kick to Donegal. Can you lip read? Here's Declan Bonner. Declan has scored 1 point in this game so far. And it remains at just that. The wind is a factor though, Peter.
It is quite a strong breeze. I think Declan had to kick the ball into that quite strong breeze there.
Come on, Frank, face it up. Keeping track of the positions here. Martin Gavigan is now centre half back. Noel Haggerty is midfield with Brian Murray. John Duffy, centre half forward. James McHugh, right half forward. Noel Maren Monaghan. Frank McEnany. Not a deal happening ahead of him. Everybody tightly marked. Uses his midfield partner instead. Porrick McShane. Safely tucked in the hands of Gary Walsh. And that's the end of it. The first half in which Monaghan came to battle and battled magnificently to lead at half-time. 1 goal and 7 points to 6 points. Can Donegal make the comeback? Can outsiders Monaghan hold on? It's a second half you cannot afford to miss, and you won't by staying with us on the Gaelic Game on UTV. Welcome to viewers in the United States of America and Canada. Welcome to another riveting game of Ulster Championship football. Donegal have placed Manus Boyle centre half forward to begin the second half. James McHugh's gone corner forward. Here's Peter Duffy. Posing a big problem for Matt Gallagher. But Matt gets back goal side of him. Now Declan Lochman robbed in there by John Joe Doherty. It's gone wide. It's tough in there. John Conlon, terrific. Back to Martin Slowey. It's between Shovlin and McEnany. Stephen McGinnity. Gregory Flanagan. Sliding tackle foul, free kick. And a chance for the super confident young man, Declan Smith from Carrickmacross Emmets. Scored one goal and 8 points in two championship games last year. Has scored 4 points in this championship game this season. Says his favourite player is Larry Tompkins. Well, if that be so, he has certainly learned from the master, albeit kicking with his left foot. Beautifully judged. And over the bar. His confidence grows, and so does that of Monaghan.
Well, certainly Larry Tompkins would have been proud of that free kick. It just crept over. Gary Walsh's grasping fingernails were just unable to take the ball down. But that could turn out to be a very important point for Monaghan. It is just the start to the second half that they're required.
Skims over the heads of both Coyle and Manus Boyle. Here's Eddie Murphy. He's been quite splendid at cornerback for Monaghan today, or wherever else he's been drawn. John Conlon, the left halfback. Declan Smith getting away, pushing Barry McGowan out of his way, so to speak. Great ball inside of Flanagan, and he couldn't field it. Gary Walsh was thinking he might have been picking it out of the cobwebs then, but Flanagan couldn't pick it up. Brian Murray trying to set Donegal going again. Mark Crossan. They need a goal, but they certainly need a score of some description. Here's James McHugh. Eddie Murphy with him. Eddie Murphy fouls him. Three Donegal. 26 minutes to go in McCool Park in Ballybuffet. And the team that knocked out the All-Ireland champions are themselves 5 points in arrears. Unsung Monaghan are now beginning to sing in tune right through the field. Declan Bono with the free kick. Kicking into the wind and at this awkward angle. Joe Coyle can't hold it down. Manus Boyle. Paddy Hegarty. Again, Coyle gets at him. This is a tenacious centre back, this fellow. But this time he concedes the free kick. ...25 minutes to go. 15 is Manus Boyle. Had a big All-Ireland final 3 years ago, had a big match against Down in the first round, and scores a big point to restore the confidence of his colleague. And did they ever need that one, Peter?
They certainly did. But again, I say that it was a foul given away unnecessarily by Monaghan. The headman back, they had no call to foul, and they should know that from that distance and in that range, from that angle, Manus Boyle simply will not miss, so they must avoid conceding needless free kicks.
In 21 Ulster Championship games over the last 7 years, Donegal have suffered only 4 losses. No doubt Monaghan would like to make it one more. Into the side comes John Gilday. Tony Boyle. Tony Boyle to Paddy Hegarty. It opens up ahead of him. Now it closes down. Now it's Boyle. Manus. It's Donegal trying to initiate a comeback.
Come on, up for it.
Brian Murray. Donegal showing their mettle now. Tony Boyle in before David King. Is there an out ball? If there is, it's John Duffy. John Duffy to Brian Murray. Hauled down. Now it's Paddy Hegarty, then James McHugh. Wild, oh goodness me. It's not James McHugh's form, it's not Donegal's form. Brian Murray was almost through, and he's trying to inspire them.
Almost through indeed, but on that occasion, Monaghan didn't foul. They jockeyed, they pressurised, they closed down the space, forced James McHugh to kick, and wide the ball went. But you must say it was a minor let-off for Monaghan on that occasion.
Now it's Stephen McGinnity. John Joe Doherty with him. Duffy was the man in the middle. Oh, there's some score. There is some score. Stephen McGinnity. ...13 minutes to go. Charlie O'Donnell's in the game for Donegal. John Duffy. Can he find a way through? Looking for Paddy Hegarty! And a lovely flick by Hegarty. It's almost become a dying art now. A touch of the Matty McLeanans and a touch of the Paddy Hegarty's then. And not his day or Donegal's at the moment. It's Barry McGann for Donegal. Been let carry the ball. Tony Boyle. He's dumped a combination of Joe Coyle and Martin Slowey.
Once again, I mean, Monaghan had that situation under control. The foul was needless, and the chances are a man of spoil will punish them.
The line just ahead of him there is the 20-metre line, but the free kick is about, what, 35 metres out. Manus Boyle, the taker. Joe Coyle with his upraised hands. Well, I don't know what they were thinking of. Joe Coyle, whatever he did anyway, it worked. And here's Peter Duffy to Declan Smith. Barry McGowan, the nearest defender. Now John Joe Doherty, number two. Stephen McGinnity. Stephen McGinnity to Peter Duffy. Peter Duffy looks for the target and finds it beautifully. His second point of the game. And with 10 minutes to go, Monaghan lead 110 to 8 points. A difference of 5 points.
Well, that was quite remarkable because Donegal had the chance of a free kick, which they could have pointed. The short one didn't work out. Monaghan counter-attacked. And Monaghan score what could be a vitally important score.
Michael Slowey looks for Peter Duffy, beaten by Matt Gallagher. Drops to Stephen McGinnity. He's in. He's through. Can he score? Yes, he can. It's celebration time for the Monaghan supporters. They're delighted. Why not? Why not? Martin Gavigan lets it roll to Brian Murray. Brian Murray's transferred to Kildare again. A jersey pull, a free kick against Frank McEnany.
At this stage, Monaghan just have to avoid conceding a goal. That should be their only objective in defence, avoid conceding a goal.
Murray getting it in, it drops down now, here's the chance for Barry McGowan. John O'Connor stood firm, now it's James McHugh, they need the goal. Here's Frank McEnany, their skipper. They've got 3 minutes to survive. But they've played splendidly, Monaghan. They really have. McShane. Oh, it's a wonderful point. A wonderful point. And surely that's the insurance now. Lockman, Murphy, Duffy, Coyle, McGinnity. All these fellas are in contention for man of the match. It's Joe Coyle, the young man. But he's a centre-back. He's not expected to score those. But we'll hear about this fella again, Peter.
He's had a tremendous game. He probably had a shaky start, but he settled down magnificently. And he has marked, I think, 3 different players during the course of this game. He's a tremendous prospect for the future.
Declan Smith having one of the last kicks of the game. And over it goes. And for Declan, it's a 6th point of the game. And he too will be in contention. 114 to 8 points.
Yes, again, beautiful strike. Over the bar, end of match.
It's all over in McCool Park in Ballybofey. Monaghan of the marvellous spirit. Monaghan, who more than any other team in Ulster will certainly never ever lie down. 114 to 8 points with a scoreline like that, and most of the scores from play, Peter McGrath, there is simply no argument.
And it was a tremendous display by Monaghan, individually and collectively. They came here to do a job. They've done that job very magnificently, really. Donegal in the day were found wanting. Possibly Donegal picked against Down. Who is to know? But Monaghan today put on a display second to none. All credit to them.
The Monaghan fans are ecstatic. All set up for a semi-final to Sabre. Monaghan against Cavan in 2 weeks' time. What a wonderful day for Monaghan football. You know, looking at the supporters after the game, you think they'd won not just the Ulster, but the All-Ireland itself, even the World Cup. Marvellous scenes of celebration. Why not? Because the young team performed splendidly. And one of those young men, Declan Smith. Not alone did you win, but you won in style.
Well, we set ourselves a target after the Laois game. We put up a disappointing performance at Croke Park, and our target was to come up here and get a win against Donegal, and thankfully that's the way it turned out.
We always felt we could do it. Nobody really gave us a chance. We were written off all week in the papers, but we felt we could run the ball at Donegal if they could run it at us. And we've a young team. We'd build on that.
We were under no pressure coming in here. You know, we got out of Division 4 football this year and went up, and probably didn't do ourselves justice against Laois in the quarter final of the league, and that game probably helped us and bridged the gap somewhat. And I think out there we proved that there's not that much difference between Division 4 or Division 1. You know, it's all on the day.
Well, I'd have to say after that, Timmy, you know, disbelief, I suppose, is about the only thing we can say. Like, you know, we're stunned, and they came here to do a job and they've achieved it.
They're always a tough battling team in the Championship, Monaghan. But I'd have to say they came here as outsiders, and everyone would have to accept. But the way they went about it, right from the goalkeeper saving the penalty at the start, from that to the last kick, you know, there was a style about them, and there was an attitude in the team. I mean, that it's going to be hard for anyone to beat.
I'm very happy, Monaghan, and there, Brian. Donegal, they must be devastated.
Yes, devastation would probably be the proper word, Adrian, because this morning potential Ulster All-Ireland champions and tonight gone from competition. And within the county, I suppose, there was an air of expectancy that we would go quite a distance this year, and we were gone. So devastation, I suppose, would be like...
Brian, a real glory day for Monaghan.
Yes, the end, except for the immediate team management. And no one believed they could do it, but they showed today a great hunger and a desire to win, and they're there on right to, I would have to say, a certain night.
Were you, Martin,
thinking
about that?
It's going to be a tough game for us. Fair play to Monaghan today. They totally deserved the match. We're far more hungry than Donegal. And I mean, it proved today that it's all about on the day. That's what happens on the day, and that's what it's all about. And Monaghan, by far the hungrier side, and totally deserved that one. And they're going to be very, very hard to beat.
I'm sure they are. Well, a dramatic game up there at Ballybuffet, and Frank, as usual, was on hand to hear the reaction from the fans.
Well, I'm a Monaghan woman. I'm actually on the executive Monaghan County Board, and I think that we have an awful, awful lot to be proud of in Monaghan.
Very disappointed. We're looking forward to the Ulster final, matter of fact.
Do you think that's part of the problem? More Donegal people and players were looking forward to the Ulster final?
No, I don't think so. No, I don't think so. Even though it looked out there today that they were looking for Sunday week, you know. No, very disappointed. Everything was going so well.
My own opinion is Monaghan as far as they're going to go. Not saying that because they beat us today, but they're not a great side. It's just Donegal did not perform in any section of the field today.
It was a poor display, I thought, from Donegal. They could have played better. Like, when you beat the All-Ireland Champions, you're supposed to go on further, like, but they just didn't play as well as they could.
Were you surprised that Monaghan were as hot today?
Well, not a bit, because they're a hard team to beat in the Championship, and always are a hard team to beat in the Championship. Play very well.
And what about this big game against Cavan now?
Mad to get at Cavan now.
I'm sure they are. But, Brian, Donegal outplayed. Were they outthought as well on the bench?
Well, they worked the same tactic as the Cavan team last Sunday. They put a runner at full forward, and I thought Donegal erred somewhat in letting Matt Gallagher go out the pitch. Matt's always good about the house, Adrian, and he's a little short in pace, and given his age at 32, out the pitch wasn't where he should have been, and he was really cleaned out of it out the pitch. But when he was in close to goals, he handled the situation very, very well. I felt possibly by saying that, I would have to say that the attitude generally throughout Donegal, they showed a lethargic approach to the game, and yeah. There was no long game. maybe you have to
very briefly, Donegal complacent?
So, I mean, throughout the county, we're expecting, maybe they're looking forward to the financial area. I think they can't do that, and I think that the problem was that Monaghan really done their homework well in Donegal, and maybe okay. We didn't our homework good enough.
We'll have to leave it there. We'll be back shortly as the ATN News. Join us then. Plenty of action. We'll be back in the Gaelic game shortly. See you then. Bye-bye. Still plenty of action to come yet, but as always, we'll take an in-depth look at that senior game. Brian, I thought it was a great game, actually, but a penalty in the first minute for Donegal, they missed it.
But I have to say, I would have been disappointed. Poorly struck the penalty, as you can see here. Much too close to the goalkeeper, John O'Connor. And if you take it that he's 6'3", there's an obvious place to put a penalty with a 6'3" goalkeeper, not very low into the corner. Maybe Martin will comment, he's an expert in penalties.
What do you think of that, Martin? I was thinking about perhaps the penalty spot should be moved in.
Yeah, well, I think it's a decision the player to make whether he's going to use strength or he's going to place the ball in the corner. And I mean, it's up to himself to make that decision, direct him into the power. I think that maybe what's happened at the minute is that managers are actually telling players, if you're going to give away a goal, actually try to concede the penalty, because there's only a 50-50 chance at the very most in Gaelic football that you can actually, that the penalty will be scored. So I think that maybe something should be looked at, something maybe even give 2 points for the free or move in the penalty thing from the free, resulting free.
You're talking about goals. Actually, we can move along now and take a look at Declan Lockman's goal. And shades of luck about this one. I think he was going for a point.
And then roughly get away with it. But I think Lockman took a shot. He went for a point, all right. And I think Gary was kind of and hit the target. I think Gary should have tried to put the ball out, and it hit the post and went into the net. And as we'll see later on, Donegal had one that hit the post and came back out. Maybe that's a bit of luck. On
questions about the keeper there?
Yeah, definitely Gary's beyond the hat. One of them for a keeper, I think that Gary should have tried to actually tip the ball over the bar or put it out wide. He'd be disappointed with himself.
Brian, it was a hard game. It wasn't really a dirty game, but one incident, Brian Murray got himself involved and got booked, and he was a wee bit lucky just to get away with the booking.
Well, I suppose we have the advantage of the TV camera here, which referee Corn hadn't got. Frustration had set into the Donegal camp at that stage, and a little indiscipline. Brian actually was pushed in the back, but he definitely should have walked if the referee Corn, I'm sure, had seen that incident. He would have walked, and deservedly so, I would have to say.
But Martin, there was great confidence all over from Monaghan. They went up, they had the hunger. Nobody expected them to win, but they expected to win. And I think Declan Smith epitomised it for me. The fella was all over the place, and he took scores, great quality scores.
Yeah, he's a very natural footballer, as we'll see here. He gets a great score at the outside of his left foot. This thing, maybe Art has gone or Gaelic Coughlin's back into this. But all the forwards, that's the one thing they have. They've scoring forwards, and that's important. If you want to win matches at that level, you've got to have scoring forwards. And the forwards scored something like 1-7 from play today, where Donegal got 2 points. And that really is the difference, is the scoring forwards and the ball going up. They played a two-man full forward lane, which left it difficult in the Donegal defence, and they worked that well.
Now, Brandon, the second half, Donegal did hit back, and whenever it's for you, the ball goes into the back of the net, but with Paddy Haggerty, very unlucky. They went to the post, as we said at the start of the show.
Yes, John Duffy flights the ball in very well, and Paddy gets a great flick on the ball. But as Martin mentioned there earlier, you know, that's when your luck's in, your luck's in. As you can see there, another inch, and we're back in the ball game, because at that stage, there was only 4 points between the sides and 15 minutes to go.
And Martin, more errors of judgment, less for Donegal. Manus Boyle had the free, 4 points behind. He did the quick free, almost looking for the goal, a mistake.
Yeah, it was definitely a bad mistake. Manus, who normally is a very active player, and he should have went for the score, because there were 11 minutes left and there were only 4 points behind Donegal at that stage. And I mean, you see now Monaghan come up the field, quick ball up the field, and they get a score up at us. Inside, get the ball in, and Declan Smith lays it back out here to McGinnity, who plays us. They hold on to the ball, which is a good sign of forwards as well. They're confident on the ball, and Peter Duffy, he's been a real find for them. He's scored a great score. But Donegal really is a mistake. We should have taken that score. Actually, Lee James and Brian Murray had 2 times at him, and we've been right back in the match. So 11 minutes left to go again.
Monaghan are
going to
be a real set in the semi final.
Yeah, Calvin Monaghan, as everybody in Calvin Monaghan, everybody be looking forward to a great match. But we realise we're going to have to improve immensely on our performance against Antrim to stay with that Monaghan team. They really look very good today.
Brian, what went wrong? We were all here last week, and I think everybody, to be fair, was confidently expecting Donegal to win this one. You certainly were expecting it. What went wrong today?
Well, I suppose no more than the rest of the county and the players within themselves. It would be very hard to shield them from the sort of conversation that was flying throughout the county. In one of the interviews there, Frankie Doherty mentioned about getting ready for an Ulster final, and I suppose within myself, that I thought that's what we were getting ready was for an Ulster final against Derry. And it's very hard to guard against complacency, but complacency was there. But we looked tired today as well, Adrian. Maybe too many matches. I think at one stage Donegal played 11 matches in 13 weeks, and the birds come home to roost. What people do forget, Donegal is a very, very big county, and a lot of Irish players do a lot of travelling within the county to train. And we had a great run in the National League, and that, maybe that deal came to tear on the result. Couldn't take away from Monaghan's performance, though, the hunger that they showed out there today. We didn't match it, and that was the difference between the two sides. We had the experience, but we didn't match the hunger.
Okay, man of the match now, you had so many
connectors. Well, you give it to him the time, because if you take a look, they didn't even use the substitution, so they're very happy with their starting 15. And you had Edmund Murphy at the back, who had a very fine game along with John Conlon, and the ponytail centre-half Joe Coyle, and then you had Pádraig McShane in the middle of the field. And up front, you had Peter Duffy and Michael Slowey, but I had to go for Declan Smith. He scored the points when Monaghan needed them early in the game to settle them. And then at the beginning of the second half, there was a free there, and he about got it no more. And that was a very vital one. And then, of course, he put the icing on the cake with the last point of the game. But I think probably a feature that we didn't pick up here on the video tonight would be a great ball that he played inside the defence to number 12, Gregory Flanagan, which you would have seen in the edit of highlights earlier. But probably the ball in the match, and the match. I thought his contribution by and large was of 6 points was, you know, made for me definitely the best contribution to the Monaghan success today.
Okay, gentlemen, we'll be back in a few moments for a state of more action, this time from the Bank of Ireland Leinster Championship clash at Navan, where Dublin made their long awaited entrance against Louth. We join at 17 minutes in, your commentator, Ger Canning.
Paul Beelan playing it inside here, and this is where Keith Galvin pops up, ostensibly the right corner back. Brian Steins going for the score off the post and over the bar. This is broken up here to Vinnie Murphy. Can he get more into the game? Vinnie Murphy going for a point, and he does so. Well, that's exactly what the Dublin management and fans, I'm sure, have been calling for. Brian Steins, a judicious use of the hand pass inside to Jason Sherlock. First taste of the action, closed down by Jerry Kern. But it's a loud defence that's being carved open right now. Once again into Sherlock, pulled down, penalty. O'Donnell against Clark, 7 points to one. A great save, a wonderful save. Niall O'Donnell has kept loud in this championship match in a meaningful way. Colin Kelly being policed by Dermot Deasy. Nicely across. Jerry Curran raiding, winning the free kick, taking it quickly himself. Oh, it's a goal! A goal by Cahill Hanlon. It's exactly what the loud following has wanted, and it's exactly what the game requires. A run here, Charlie Redmond, great delivery inside to Sherlock once again. Back indeed to Keith Galvin. Galvin leaves it behind. This is Jason Sherlock, pulled down the Tavares rectangle. Loud will have to be very careful here. This was it again. That's who went down. So close to the rectangle. The kick put over the bar. That a first point in the championship for Jason Sherlock, man who created the penalty earlier on. Stephen Melia. Kick down towards Ollie McConnell. Couldn't contain it. That was because he was being fouled. Dropped in nicely. Put over the bar. One they really did need. That's his second point. Both of them coming in for the second half. That's in towards Stephen White. Stephen White. Serious like last year. But this year he scored. Charles will be in presently. Right now it's Brian Steins floating one in, broken down by Ollie McDonald, but only to a waiting dove. It's Charlie Redmond who faces the target, going forward menacingly as ever, and he knocks it over the bar towards Alan Rooney, touches it down. Stephen White looks her up quickly, back towards the substitute again, fed back to Stephen White, making it difficult for them now. They get the point at the end, and that's a goal and a point now for Stephen White. This looks very promising. Brian Steins nicely inside towards Jason Sherlock, going low, held on a free in. So Charlie Redmond to kick it. between the posts and over. A ninth point for Charlie Redmond. Paul Beelan once again to Jason Sherlock on his championship debut. 1 point so far in this match for him. Keith Galvin up there joining the attack as he's done so often, and he's put it over the bar. Gareth O'Neill judging it well. The final whistle from referee Brian White. And in the end, Dublin progressed very comfortably against the Wee County. And the final score reading Dublin 19 points, Louth 2 goals and 5 points.
Brian, they sent out a message out of there.
There's no doubt about that. They looked a superbly fit, well-drilled side, even though they haven't discovered a lot of new players. And knocking over 19 points, serve notice of what their intentions are to retain the Leicester Championship. But I would take a look at the two goals they conceded. They can't afford to quit.
More than they've been unlucky in the past few seasons, Dublin. Can they go the whole way this year?
Yeah, well, I think we actually played them in a challenge game a couple of weeks ago, and I never seen a Dublin team as sharp in all my life. I think they're all in it together, and they realise that this is their swan song, and they're going to be hard to beat. I believe that they're going to be hard to beat. I never seen them as lean and as fit as before any of the players. So I think that they're going to give it one hell of a go.
Okay, lads, thank you. We'll take a short break now. Still to come, minor hurling, Toehills tips, and a chance to win a holiday in Portugal. Welcome back. No minor football this week, but we have hurling as Derry take on Down in the minor hurling semi-final. Your commentator in this one, Frank Mitchell.
It's a big occasion and a big day here in Ballybofey. That's not as good as Niall Stevenson would have hoped for. That's good on the turn, and it's in the back of the net. It's a great finish. The scorer is Ray O'Hagan from Ballinascreen. So it's Barry Coleman with the sideline cut for Down. Gets under it well, gets it across the park. That's a good turn and a good effort. And a great move! A super finish from Johnny McGrattan. Big Johnny hits the net for Down. Cut came in from Barry Coleman. And the full forward McGrattan went to collect. The ball broke. He took possession. He turned and smacked back of the net. Horrick Matthews trying to get possession, out with Gary Gordon. Gary Gordon puts it across, and there's a white flag on that one too. Downer back in this game now. This is Eunan Murray. Gets it across. It could go to anyone now, and it's going to Peter McCluskey. He's one of the danger men. A good shot from McCluskey, and another fine point from Peter McCluskey. Good run from Martin McGlade. Good effort from Martin McGlade. There's definitely a white flag on that one. Barry Coleman. It's a stylish hurler, Barry Coleman. He didn't connect Paddy. He may have hit the net. Horrick Matthews might. And he gets the point. It's another point for the dual player, Horrick Matthews. There aren't as many scores in this match as you would expect in hurling, but there may be one coming now from Barry Coleman. There certainly is. That is the way to do it. Barry Coleman from Port Barry, another score for Down. Johnny McGrattan again. He found himself from here, McGrattan. Please, though, Johnny McGrattan, he's a blonde. Points for Derry, 1 goal and 6 points for Down. It's all to play for. Owen Farron on the run, and in the end, the referee blows up. Putting this into points, stiff freeze, and finding the target. The wind, no problem at all to him. McGrattan tried to double on it. In the end, it comes out to his co-player Gary Gordon. This is Johnny McGrattan again on the turn, and it's another point for Johnny McGrattan, and another point for Down. McGrattan makes space for himself, and he doesn't need very much of it considering he's a big man. You begin to sense that Down may win this game now, the wind in their favour. In towards the big man and the chance of a score. Stevenson clears it, and in the end it goes wide, much to the disappointment of Paddy Coulter. This is Danny McGrellis now. There's a chance of a goal for Derry. What a score! Danny McGrellis on as a sub, a saviour for Derry. Here's John McGrattan. He's prepared to run McGrattan. And in the end, he does get it through. It's a fine effort, and it's a fine score. It's Sean McGrattan. Sean McGrattan from Portaferry with the score. This is Owen Farron. Derry put it where they want to put it, up towards the Down defenders. Liam Clark covering, but it's not enough. Liam Clark's covering won't be enough because Down needed another goal. They didn't get it.
Well done to Derry. Well, a regular feature in the programme is a look at coaching. And this week, Anthony Toohill looks at the solo run.
Bouncing and solo running. It's very important to bounce it in front of you, because if you're running at pace, you shouldn't have to break straight to collect it again. Solo running, on the other hand, a little kick to yourself. It's very easy to do while you're standing, but trying to do it at full pace is a difficult way. Try to get the ball as close to yourself as possible, not put it up in the air too high or too far in front of you, so that the defender can't knock it away.
Well, time now to look at the rest of today's sports news. Here's Rod Nunn.
In Leinster, the other big football game saw Laois, as expected, come through. But what a nail-biting and controversial one-point win it proved over Carlow. This score from Damien Delaney seemed to set Laois off comfortably after 10 minutes. But then the game was put in a knife edge when Tony Kane slotted home this goal for Carlow. In the second half, Delaney was fortunate enough to goal from the rebound of his own penalty. But that had only helped bring the sides level. In the very last minutes, the winning point. Michael Turley's shot, was it over the bar? The referee said yes. The Carlow players argued furiously that it was a wide, but Laois scraped through. In Munster senior hurling, a real shock. The county synonymous with the sport and favourites for the championship have been tipped out at the semi-final stage. Limerick the winners by a single point in Cork.
It's a ball that's kind of based because no gives it away, so he does. Barry Kirby. Way out the field. Oh, that's a real fury. Barry Kirby. Nine ball. Sean O'Neill. Back to Kirby. And the radar is working very well for Mr. Kirby. An incredible tally.
In Armagh's Senior Football Championship, victory for Sarsfields at the Athletic Grounds, 3 points to spare over Silverbridge. But it was Silverbridge who caused the early surprise. Casual defence, Paddy Hughes got enough of his fingertips on the ball to net. Just a point up, the turning point for Sarsfields came when Liam Murray was unceremoniously upset to score from the penalty with a little help from the upright. Silverbridge battled Emily, but from Paul Stern, enough. Winners 1-9 to 1-6. As senior hurling, wins for Katy and for Middletown over Shehalans and Derry Noose. And while nothing can quite compensate for the defeat at Ballybuffet today, Donegal's Paddy Hegarty can afford a smile after being named the Ulster GAA Writers Merit Award winner for May. It was the Glencolum Kill players' storming display against Down and Clonus which clinched the award. And Friday night was a night of celebration at Dunedin. There gathered some of the biggest names in GAA to honour Jim McKeever, a giant as a player with Derry. Contribution as the inspiration over three decades at St Mary's Teaching College was acknowledged in some style. This specially commissioned pictorial record of a great moment in the 1958 All-Ireland Final with Dublin, just one of the surprises on the night. Many household names have been through the McKeever Footballing Academy, and this fight saw one chosen as a McKeever All-Star panel from the last 35 years.
Terribly interesting because they came from such a long distance apart. I mean, we had people going back to the 50s and 60s, and we had right up to the present day. And it's really nice to see players from different generations being considered and selected in the same team. I think that is very, very nice indeed.
And finally, some of the other sporting news of the day. Registered thrilling 2 wicket win over Ulster. Fisher looks certain to have won the.
Time now for a regular competition. Last week we wanted to know which sport Aidan Donnelly played as an Irish international. Was of course basketball. And congratulations to Mrs. Amagucky and Quatra and Mahara who wins a holiday in Menorca. On offer this week on the Gaelic Game is a week's holiday for a family of four in Portugal. The flights are out of Belfast, a one-bedroom apartment in the surroundings of the Praia da Rocha apartments on the Algarve. The holiday is the first week of October, and we want to know where will the Ulster football final be played this year? Is it A, Croke Park in Dublin, B, Casement Park in Belfast, or C, Clonus, County Monaghan? Ring us with your answers on 0891 963, or from the south 1550 111 444. The lines are open until Tuesday at midnight. The numbers again are 0891 909 363, or from the Republic 1550 111 444. A special family break, a week for four in Portugal. Good luck.
As I say, I'd already tipped Derry to play Donegal in the Ulster final. I suppose I can't really go back at this stage. I expect a very tight game, and I'll have to go for Derry at this stage, Adrian. And that's based on the fact they have a very tight defence, and I think they have the capacity to close down Peter Canavan, which is the Tyrone scoring machine.
Martin, do Tyrone do they depend too much on Peter Canavan?
Probably do to an extent, all right. I think the thing against other teams that maybe haven't as good a markers as Derry, but the thing about Derry is next week, if they play Canavan in the full forward lane, they've got people to pick him up. If even Tyrone say, well, put him out to half forward lane, there's still players good enough to pick them up. And really, it's a Derry defence that's actually, and the middle of the field, that's been carrying them through matches. And it's very hard to play against them. You need at least, in Tyrone one next Sunday, at least four, if not five, of the forwards going well.
Great rivalry between them two, going back even to the league final of 92 with the incident with Plunkett Donoghue, the goal from Anthony Toholl, and now right through. They've won two league titles in an All-Ireland since then, and Tyrone have been in the doldrums.
Yes, it's amazing actually when you go back to the 1992 league final, that Tyrone had the match won, and but for the unfortunate lapse of Plunkett or Tyrone.
But the best team won that day.
The best team possibly won. Yeah, I was at the match, and I would have to say the best team did win on the day. But there's never been much between them, Adrian, and taking the championship fair today, the width of a post could decide the game next Sunday as well.
So Martin, you obviously will give a vote as well to Derry then too. Pressure on them again.
Well, there's definitely our pressure because now they're favourites now definitely for the Ulster final, and they're probably favourites for the All-Ireland. There's definitely pressure on them. But taking the Armagh match, they played really well. But in the league semi-final against Tyrone, if Tyrone actually had put away some of their scores the first half, they could have been put them under real pressure. So it'll depend on Tyrone up on their performance. You know, really.
Thanks, of course, to our studio guests, Bram McAniff, Martin McHugh. And next week, it's the first semi-final between Derry and Tyrone. So far in the championship, two of the D's are gone. I wouldn't put 3D on anyone after today. Until next week, bye-bye.
Got the signal from referee Curran. Here's the chance. And a terrific save by John O'Connor.
Nothing that new on this time. Look at Paddy Hegarty. Get out of the lovely flick by Hegarty. It's all the big... Face by George O'Doherty. Now it's back to Declan Lockman. And Gary Walsh went for the game of the incident.